Thank you enough, and I'm deeply, deeply honored. And I said this to my people here at the Institute, this is not just a prize for one person. It's impossible to carry such an honor, right? So I would be happy to share this honor with all of you at ICRED. You know, you're my great friends, even though I haven't had a chance to spend a longer time with you all. But I'm really, really happy to be among you and honored. And I cannot thank you enough. So, domo arigato gozaimasu. It's like a dream come true, and it's almost unreal in a way. And I told this story yesterday, the whole day, to everybody who asked me. It was just a miracle. I was in Amsterdam with my wife. We went to a great concert. And in the morning, we went to a coffee place to have a breakfast. And we were about to order, and obviously I had zero idea this would be happening, you know. Of course, in the back of my mind, you know, today the Nobel Prize will be given, but I didn't expect this at all, certainly not at my relatively young age, right? So at maybe 11, sometimes around 11, the phone rings in my pocket. I feel it, the vibration. I take it up, and on the phone, it says a phone number I don't know, but underneath it says Sweden. So I go outside, and it is the call, you know, it's the call. And that was such an incredible moment. And I don't know, I almost, you know, I lost my body weight, and it was just incredible. Of course, the component of luck is always involved, right? Pick the right experiment. But then sort of serendipity, like the teaching of my PhD supervisor, my doctor father, you know, Johann Mulzer, I knew about the old proline work in the 70s that was somehow forgotten. People didn't think about it, and they didn't know about the mechanism and all that, right? And then at Scripps, I was working with these enzymes, with these protein catalysts, and I looked at the crystal structure of these enzymes, and I saw there's an amino group and there's an acid. And then, I know it's like really naive, but amino acid came to my mind. And then of course, everything fell into place. You know, how does proline work? It works like an aldolase. It works via an enamine mechanism. And this was something people haven't really appreciated then, right? Then to do this experiment, I felt a little bit silly and maybe naive and maybe almost, perhaps everybody knows this is a stupid idea. It's everybody knows small organic molecules cannot be catalysts, right? Because at the time that was the thinking, like nobody on the planet, I thought, was working. So I did this experiment, and I kept it a secret because I thought people would laugh at me because it's so naive, you know? So as you know, now in my lab, I try to artificially create this sense of insecurity. And I know I'm inspired by all of you guys in not only in Sapporo, but in Japan. For me, this country has been an inspiration, because you do also this crazy chemistry, right? You go into, like Noyori, he always kept saying, go to the extreme reactivity and try something that has never been tried before. And this, for me, was also an inspiration. But this moment, then doing the experiment, this insecurity, I think we should cherish this feeling, you know? It's really special. We should not feel too confident about our work. And I would also say that, you know, predicting and rational design in a way is incompatible with scientific revolutions, right? Think about it. First of all, it's the general inspiration of the Japanese style chemistry, like this radical innovativeness about it, this courage to try things that where maybe some old people would shake their head, oh, this is, no, this, everybody knows this will never work. This is an inspiration. That's why I always love to come to Japan. But then, of course, Maeda Sensei's approach to computational chemistry, to theoretical chemistry, is unique. And I was always skeptical about the potential of computational chemistry and theory to reaction design. But now I think we are at the phase where this becomes possible for the first time actually in the history of chemistry. And so I'm very open and very curious, and I want to be part of this. And that's why I joined you guys. So that's my answer. Yeah, maybe a little bit different. I expected it to be sort of even more formal, but I love this interdisciplinarity and your enthusiasm about opening up and opening up to other countries, other people, other influences, and this mixing up of you know, computation, scientific experiments, artificial intelligence. I mean, I just love that. I mean, I'm waiting for the day that we sit down and design a chemical reaction from scratch. I mean, really from scratch. And I mean, I think the only designed reaction is this cabine reaction by Maeda Sensei. But you know, maybe one day we will be able to do something like enantioselectively, and we can design a catalyst. I think, I mean, even for me, I would say, just predicting the right enantiomer would be an incredible challenge. And in none of our reactions, I was able to ever do this. It's just sort of luck, as many of you know, right? You get one enantiomer, you get 99% EE, you're very happy and grateful. But predicting this is a completely different ballgame. You know? And ultimately, maybe this work might make chemists superficial, right? In a certain way. Maybe you don't need this style of chemistry that we do at some point. I don't think this is happening very soon though. And I'm one who's not afraid of such a time when chemistry, like, remember in the old days, we didn't have laundry machines, right? So the people would wash the laundry with their hands, and it would take hours, right? And then these laundry machines came, and now this is something, you know, we don't even think about. And perhaps one day this will be true for chemistry, and I'm not worried about it, because then we can do other great things. And you know, there's so many things we can do and can be excited about. My message is always the same, and thanks for asking this. It's a very simple message. It's not a revolutionary one, but it's a very important one. And this is, follow your enthusiasm. Do what you really love to do. And don't anticipate the outcome, or don't get attached to the outcome. I was never, you know, doing any of what I did for a Nobel Prize, honestly, right? And I do this because I love my work. I love what I do in the lab. And I share this love and this passion with the people in my group. And if you realize, actually, this work in the lab or this work at the computer, it's kind of interesting, but it doesn't make me happy. Maybe it's a good idea to do something else that you really love. I think it will make you a happier person, right? So that's my message.
Thank you so much.